I've been covering really very large patterns very deliberately, and many people ask me a question about being comprehensivist and then being competent, and what I've learned to do in disciplining myself is to, I can go in, plunge in depth for various periods of time. There's something you really need to know about and you really, really go after and let nothing impede you. Having, however, started from as comprehensive a base as possible, I really never lose the fundamental comprehensivity, and you can come back really quite rapidly from any subject. For instance, there's a period when I really needed to get out the sanitation for dwellings, and I spent 2 years just developing a mass production bathroom. But I really did find a great deal, and just such simple matters that there was only one man in the United States making designing all the toilet bowls at all the different companies, and found there was nobody really knew why a toilet bowl was the way it was except this one man, and he'd inherited his art from some English craftsmen, and he was in a little top room in a building in Toledo, Ohio, and Standard Sanitary and Kohler and all of them were getting their information from him. And I found that in making the toilet bowl, so the tolerances that can be maintained between forming the original regular ceramics and you're getting your clays, and then before you bake it, one thing, another thing, a lot of weight, things go out around, so you could not have any machinist kind of tolerance at all. If you hold to a quarter of an inch in diameter of an opening, you're doing very, very well. And all this really became very impressive to me, so I decided to really go in pretty, very deeply, and I found no scientists had really ever looked at the plumbing. Just think what we're really saying. This is in our day, scientists are not looking at plumbing. They find fault with the plumbing, they call the plumber. But nobody is asking scientists to look at plumbing and say, you're pure scientist, you mustn't make your own this kind of nonsense. And here all these extraordinary chemistries that are going into the toilet and very valuable chemistries are getting all pushed together. Nature is taking a lot of trouble to separate them out, and then we deliberately push them together. And when nature does separating out, if you ever get into mining or refining, you find it's quite a job to separate out. You spend a lot of energy separating out. So to deliberately let things go back together, it could not be more unintelligent. So I found that right in the very life of the people who are supposedly being educated to do logical things, right under their nose in their everyday life, they were missing things. So this called for a whole lot of attention. I get deeply into, I found that I could produce stainless steel toilet bowls in two halves of stampings and get absolutely fine tolerances. I was able to really find out how many gallons of water we need to flush out the toilet. We find that people are getting rid of a pint of water and using seven gallons to flush it away. All this beautiful, valuable water coming down the hills that we need so badly. It all began to kind of hurt if you got in there deeply to see how much advantage could be found for humanity if you really got in. So it was very easy to get these fine tolerances, beautiful stainless steel and so forth. And anyway, the big point is that once you understand, you can be a generalist and plunge. You really dare to pay no attention to anything else in science. I've been in so many different fields that plunge very deeply in many things, whether it's cartography. When I do, there's maybe 6 months, 2 months, maybe 2 years that you're really off there. Then you come back in the big swing again. There are a number of subjects which, And I have very good records of all these things, and so that there are a lot of slides, and I've just been really handling thoughts themselves, and I want to come back now really to artifacts and slides, and particularly to artifacts because I want to review for a minute with you my own grand strategy of how I carry on. When I made up my mind to peel off and commit myself precessionally to the what had been called the side effects, but that is to really how to make ecology, you get on with ecology and play the game that life is trying to play, of making the big show work and not just looking out for yourself. When I did that, risking, realizing there's nobody to mark your paper from there on, there's nobody to pay you, that only nature would support you if you're, my theory was, if I was doing what nature wanted you to do, I'd find myself being supported, but be absolutely so indirect that you'd never be able to say this is for that. And that I must not get scared, because it doesn't seem to be supported right now, whatever it is, you must really keep on. And in doing that, I realized I must not waste any time. You're going to have to be terribly sensitive. You have to use everything that you're born with as a child, with intuition and sensitivity, realize, am I really doing the right thing? This is where a child can really get in the forest and get to some critical point and get to do things pretty carefully. So you can really be sensitive. So this meant then that if I had just my one lifetime to try to get somewhere, therefore I really have to get a whole lot out of my time. And I said, my experience tells me then that I've listened to a great many people talking to a great many people and trying to persuade the other that this is the way things are. And I made up my mind that people that I listened to were really not listening too much. They sort of wait for their turn to speak and sound off the... So I decided that what I would do, I would discipline myself not to talk to people unless they asked me to talk to them. I've been in effect really asked to talk, and so that I'm talking to you because you're here to be talked to. Because I'm sure this is the only time really people are listening, when they want to hear what you have to say, when they say so. So that became a basic discipline. I made up my mind then if I was not going to use words, which so many people do use, as my prime approach, what else did I have? And I said, I see that nature is transforming continually, and it would be possible to, if we can comprehend the principles that she really is using structurally and mechanically, associated with socially, really feel your chemistry and feel your technology, feel your hydraulics, pneumatics, electromagnetics, your interattractions, your repulsions, if you really feel those things, it would be possible then for you to take, because nature is continually transforming the environment, that you can really participate in the environmental transforming. And the only reason that you're really doing what you're doing is that because you feel that you've discovered that this is why we are here. We are here for one another. And in a sense, you've already discovered that older people have very powerfully conditioned reflexes, not easy for them to adjust to the new, to take advantage of the new. They tend to hold on to the old. Therefore, I said, my focus is going to be on not just looking out, but primarily on the absolutely youngest life that has no conditioned reflexes, and to try to give that youngest life, provide environments for that youngest life so that within which environment that child would prosper. Be one reason why you find me lying down, remembering how I acted when I was a little kid on a bed, trying to get off of bed. I paid a great deal of attention to saying, inasmuch as there really are only a certain number of transformations, motions that I've given you, there really are, I find there are categories and really hierarchies of tools and matter how fancy the tools look, there's pounding, there's pushing, and there's scraping off, there's the horizontals, the pulling, pushing and pullings. Things get down to really relatively few things that can be done. I said, I think that that child, all the things a child is doing is very experimental, is finding how it can stand up. It is a superb research operation. And when that little child later on begins to tear paper, it isn't because the child is being mischievous. The child needs to know what coheres and doesn't cohere. He's got to keep testing things, because having been so informed, so insistently informed by gravity about falling, you must know what you can hold on to that won't come apart when you're falling. That's logical, isn't it? Because he's grabbed at the bed and so forth. Instinctively does that. So he's got to keep testing what holds together. So it's going to... They tear newspaper, and they're looking for things that look tougher. They tend to take your best papers. They tend to look at the thing, try pulling apart things that people consider very valuable around the house, linen, so they might finally pull that apart. Finally, they find these things do hold. So I said, if you realize what it is they're trying to find out, it'd be very easy to really arrange things in their environment so they find the things that they need to experiment with, and they don't have to use a lamp cord to find out about tension. They can have another kind of a cord, and be much easier to do it. So that the idea then was, how do you develop environments that are favorable for the new life, within which the new life can get all the information really needs it in the most logical way, and it doesn't tend to engender fear, or that when experimenting, doing the things they are doing, something you're hit in the head, or that the society is going to say, stop that, and find themselves obnoxious to society. I felt all this could really be done. So my first focus then becomes developing artifacts instead of words. And by artifacts and tools, I would mean a building is a tool, a great ship is a tool. So the artifact may be, I'm not talking about spoons and rulers and rather small devices, but any of the participation in using the principles of nature to take apart and reassociate and so forth. I'm really talking, generalizing this for you very, very much, but the point is that I find that nature already has things in certain association. She herself dissociates them gradually. She takes her own rock apart, and we could learn then how you take things apart. You find that they're very valuable chemistries that temporarily associate this way, that can be disassociated and reassociated in preferred ways. So that's what we do in mining, going around the world, finding there are certain resources, and then deciding where you're going to begin to separate that out. You've got ore. You have local energies available that will make it possible to do next steps of grinding or whatever you want to do. Or do you have to forward it in ships to get to another place where there are energies and so forth? There are many critical decisions made of that kind. But by and large, there's a very big, big pattern here. The metals are deposited very unevenly around the whole Earth. In effect, man goes halfway around the world and takes ore out of the ground and starts separating it. And as he goes along, sometimes leaves things behind, separates and has the residues, and keeps forwarding. And finally gets highly concentrated metals at various centers around the world. And as there's finally a maximum degree to which he separates these metals out from everything else, the chemical elements, then he starts reassociating them in preferred manner as alloys. And after that, we get to the point where things get to be made into special parts or special engines and so forth, and we begin to start assembling again in preferred ways. In other words, nature has come apart ability. She has reassociability, and you're simply participating in that in a big way. So I find that the total operation going halfway around the world to get the right metals, to bring them to certain concentrated places while concentrating them themselves, separating them out, a lot of sorted, very valuable materials, a And you start researching the preferred ways, whether it's going to be some kind of an engine or it's going to be some kind of a building, some other kind of tool. And then having gone into this very great complex undertaking, which is going to take months, it's going to take years to get those mines operating, the ships, it's a very big complex thing, taking a lot of time. And I got to then to demonstrate that all the time has been invested by man, all the energy invested by man, are going to be worthwhile having invested that way, so that what I have to do then is to arrange to get the what you produced to available to the most people around the world. So in effect, I now have produced something that's been assembled from all over the world. Now I must arrange to get what I have to all of the world again, to make it most available to the most people. This gets to be the optimum big pattern that you're concerned with. I find then that if I do get it to the most people, available to most people, then we can find out very quickly whether this really worthwhile doing, and how do you improve on it if it's pretty good. And in the end, humanity ought to be gaining advantage. Humanity ought to be gaining advantage of greater health, and more time, a little greater longevity, more freedom to undertake more things. We're continually trying to free up humanity from being locally preoccupied as a local machine, to get freer to use more and more of its head, to look at more and more of the pattern, to be able then to be more and more effective with its mind, understanding principles rather than and realizing how much more it could do with the energies that are available in the universe on the ends of levers to do the physical work, that we're really here to do the mental work. So that my total pattern then is halfway around the world inbound, halfway around the world outbound, which sum total is once around the world. There's a whole lot of energies that are involved. And I find that this makes it possible for me to get into a very discrete pattern. Next thing, I can really understand my totality and have a way of judging whether what you're doing is worth the doing. Such patterns I've just spoken to you about really are then highly documentable, what the dire is involved, and make some very good calculations in advance whether this is going to turn out to be worthwhile to humanity. I do not look on these projects in the terms very ever about whether people like the looks of what I'm doing for the moment. I'm always concerned with really how it works. And it usually looks all right, because I'm concerned with the, not only how do you get it there, but how do you maintain it? And how do you in the end recover it, take it away when that becomes obsolete because you've done something better? So you get that in the recirculation. So I see a total responsibility in this design, getting things to people, not trying to sell it to people, but trying to make it available to people. I'm very glad to be doing this program under the Bell Service, because one of the examples I use in industrialization, I consider by far the best example operating in the whole history of industrialization, is the telephone service. That is, you don't try to sell people telephones. What you do, you're selling service. You're making it possible for people to communicate, and if you make it, the easier you make it to communicate and the more accurately they can communicate, the more people are going to use the service. So it's a very interesting matter. People still think you've got to sell things to people, because in order to get it improved, people want to, they're going to demand a very good product. The telephone company learned that they didn't wait till people say, I don't know whether I can afford a new telephone. They didn't sell the telephone. They sold the people telephones. Then they'd had telephone architects, and they'd had Napoleonic and voodoo and Georgian telephones, and nobody could possibly sell the telephone to anybody else anyway. So the telephone company simply sold the service, and they found that every time they could find a little better way, they could really afford to scrap enormous systems, because they could give so much more service that the number of people who use the service go up that fast. And so the telephone has continually been improved. So when I'm thinking about big systems and world systems, I find that this is a very good field to work and take working examples. I also then spoke about recirculating, using materials. The telephone company, when I was young, we lived just outside Boston. Our telephone company, our telephone number was number 10, so early in the experience of telephones. And it was not long, a few years before, they began learning to get more messages over the same cross-section of copper wire. First we just one, and then we began to get more, got up to 28, and then there was an increase, we went up to over 200. The next increase, I remember, went to over 1,100, then went up into some thousands. By 1930, the chief engineer of the Bell Lab said that at that time the telephone service was being employed by about 10% of humanity. Said they'd be able to increase the telephone service so the whole world would be furnished with telephone service, and that during that time the telephone companies would neither have to mine nor buy another pound of copper. That during that whole time there would be copper sellers, because they found the rate at which they were learning how to get more messages per cross-section of copper was so vast that there actually was a gain. The amount of copper they already had was a copper mine, and it'd be adequate. That has turned out to be the fact. We have now one communication satellite weighing a quarter of a ton, outperforming the transoceanic communications capability and fidelity of 175,000 tons of copper cable, one quarter of a ton. This is the rate which is suddenly an enormous step up, doing more with less. And my whole hope of how we were going to get all of humanity at a higher standard of living starts then looking out for the young life. You don't have to quarrel with them, because you give them something that really works, and that child, that's what he's going to use. And his reflexes are going to be conditioned to that which works, and that is what's intelligent. He won't have anything else from there on. And so that I said, it's a long pull job we're doing. You know, we have to start with children, and have to get a whole lot understood before we can get anywhere. Because I found that the time I started what I was doing, people were thinking about architecture and buildings in such a powerfully conditioned reflex. It was just incredible that when I, in 1929, the first presenting the Max in-house to people, where I developed a machine for living. It really was a machine, and using the most advanced technology we had, and I was able to do it, provide a three-ton house. That I was outperforming a 200-ton conventional residence. People, you know, they were so taken up with Georgian, and so it's amazing the conditioned reflexes, and how much is really in there, almost on a fear basis, because it goes back to the power structure and the castle. What the strong man has, the man down the street who's hiring your dad, so that's the way he has what he has. The people just, their eyes were just powerfully conditioned this way. So I had, in all the things I talked to you about, I want you to realize that I never allow myself to say what they're going to look like. I'm perfectly confident if you're doing it the right way, it's going to look strange. But in due course, people discover that is the way how things really work, and they begin to like it because they can understand and feel it. As we began to get into space programs, the devices you see going off in space look very strange to people. And they didn't mind about that going off in space, but if it's something you're going to have around their house, they're going to have to live with, they've been very, very sticky about it. Now, I'm saying these things to you. I'm going to get into these strategies and a number of different projects I've gone into. But I want you to have a little feeling of the overall controls. I'm looking then as always a world project. I'm looking at it total history, I'm thinking about the total inventory of all the metals of our Earth being separated out and progressively more easy to get out. And so I began to see them. There might come a time when you wouldn't have to mine anything. In fact, this copper is I also spent 2 years in depth in the Phelps Dodge Corporation as assistant director of research at Phelps Dodge, who's the third largest copper company in the world. And I really, it was there that I did also then plunge in doing some bathrooms and several things and got into new types of automotive brakes using the steel we use. The steel is a very poor conductor, either of heat or electricity. I got into conducting metals like the aluminums and coppers for the braking that carried off the heat very much more rapidly. Yeah. So it just cut away from brake fade and more effective. And then I finally even got to, you could even have metal to metal. The Japanese had found that you had carbon brushes and copper together. They the metal didn't get worn away, and they're using it for trolley with electric trolley going along to pick up its current and not getting nowhere. And I finally could get that into a brake. I developed in Phelps Dodge various things. I got in depth there. One was Phelps Dodge was primarily copper, but the gold and silver co-occur with the copper, and they also became very much involved with tin. And America and all the world was going to need a lot of tin in World War I. Tin ores coming from Bolivia, and you get into low-grade tin ores, and there's lots and lots of low-grade tin ore. And there's something very difficult to separate out. And I found that taking the ground powdered ore, I was able to develop a centrifuge. And I had a centrifuge that had to be water-cooled so the metals didn't get to some critical heat where they break up. Because when you get spinning great weights at great velocities, there's enormous tendency to come apart. So I wanted to introduce a very powerful flame, the blowtorch flame, into the powder, and be able to centrifuge. So I had to design a completely water-cooled apparatus, which just went on. So all the heat was just at the point of contact of this flame with the powder. And I figured that you might, like a cream separator, really be able to separate the tin out, because the weights are very much more. And sure enough, it worked. I didn't get that. They didn't get it into production. They were really very scared of the centrifuge and that they might really kill a lot of people. But I did find it's actually possible then to take low-grade ores and centrifuge just like cream. And this tin was just running out. It was really beautiful. I've been able to get in quite depth in great many directions, and I've become very deeply involved with the metals and know a lot about their histories. And I would go into talking about that in due course. But I had made up my mind that this morning we'd go through some various slides. And I'm introducing to you a number of projects, some of them rather short, but I have really good slides of them. I want to take advantage of the fact that we do have something for you to visualize. And for instance, you find me getting into my map, and I was able then to develop a better method of projection and you know, where there was no visible distortion. It was very important to be able to have a world map without any visible distortion. Because if you take the Mercator map and use the land as a background for, say, percentage of resources or how many people are in that particular place, if the background is distorted, with Greenland is three times as big as Australia on the map, but the actual fact is exactly the opposite, then the relative abundance within that particular area is very misinforming. So I needed a world map that I could always, with absolutely no visible distortion, against which I could show percentages of materials and peoples, whatever I wanted to see. I needed to look at world all the time, so that's what brought me about my world map. And It is the only world map that is approximately distortion-free, both as to relative shape and relative size. So that brought me into a great deal of experience with the world map. And many, really, numbers of times I've drafted the whole world, plotted the whole world on paper, but the minute something's I've got, that's good for you too, if you go in depth, you get very familiar with the world. I found that there was something worth the finding. And what I found here was employed with the beginning in the space program. When you start then suddenly going into rocketry, and humanity is awed by the prospect and not at all sure how it's going to come out, and you start then experimentally sending enormous rockets in the sky to go great distances, people get to be quite apprehensive about where that's going to land and so forth. And so that I did make a discovery that there was a great circle around our world from America to America that didn't touch any other continent. And this would be a highly specialized kind of item, but you see North America there, and you see Florida where Cape Kennedy is, about here. And that Cape Kennedy, I've got an axis where you leave Cape Kennedy and you just miss South America, and you just miss Africa, and you just miss Australia, and you go over the neck of New Guinea, and you keep on going around, and you come back to Cape Mendocino in California, and then right back to Cape Kennedy. In other words, it was possible to find a range at which you could fire when you're not firing at the United States. I'll go around that once more, and it would be all right if one of you to come up and do something with me. Would you come up, dear? I want you to put your finger, if you sit down on the floor there, and we use this camera here, and put your pencil, put up your pencil somewhere, out just about there. I'm going to put this Cape Kennedy on there. You keep your pencil steady, will you? And I'm going to do the turning.
Okay.
I just want to have it so you can see where it's pointing. See, it's just missing South America, just missing the tip of Africa. Or if I did it right, it would. Go back again. Just misses the tip of Africa, just misses Australia, and does go over the neck of New Guinea, and then comes right back to Cape Mendocino, mm-hmm. and back to Cape Kennedy. Now, I have some slides of that, and it'd be sort of fun just to see it on the slide, because you can see the line itself. It's carefully drawn. That's a great circle. So it is the shortest way around the world. May I have the slides? It's quite interesting that in relation to that great circle, which misses everybody, what if to say, what is south of it? By the way, look, now you can see that line on here. It is north of my head is very much in the way there. It is just north of Florida on here. Now we'll turn the next picture, please. This one has just missed Africa, just missing Australia. Next, please. No, they're in wrong order. We see now where Alex missed, left, just north of Florida, just going north of South America, and just south of Africa. Next one. Now, I've got some mixed up in my homework. I've done my slides badly. in relation to that line, I had an axis of it, because there's always an axis of a great circle. And it's interesting that the, see, how many people are south of that line? For instance, South America is south of that line. And Australia is south of the line. And the Antarctic. So it's just Australia, South America. So South America has 4% of humanity. Australia has not 1%, and Antarctica is not 1%. So only 4% of humanity are south of that line. Which says it's 96% of the north of that line. Therefore, the pole, the north pole of that line, would be the nearest to the most people. And the north pole of that line is exactly, it's just in a, it's in Russia, and it is just south of Volgograd, and that's exactly where the Russians send all their rockets from. In other words, they're sending it from the place that's nearest to everybody. I don't know whether they did any working on the geography about it, but it is interesting to me that that is so. From the kind of work that I do, I often get extraordinary insights in what are the grand strategies of the big ideologies. And I think that I'm now going to come to the next slide. I'm changing my subject now, going off the map and that world strategy. Somehow or other, this set seems to be bad. You're looking at three rods on a tower, and the three rods pierce a vertical circle, and that's made out of a very high alloy aluminum strip, and so there are three hinges in that strip. There's a rivet at the point where the rod, three rods come out through the vertical circular strip. Next picture, please. Now this same strip now has been depressed, and we see the rods still going through the three corners. Next picture, please. Go back. Can you go back with the pictures? Can you go backwards? Can you go back with that one? There should be three of those pictures of the rods in line. Let me just carry on. When we get to spherical trigonometry, now we're seeing the same circle of rods is a spherical triangle, which each of the angles are quite open, about 120. We've seen the same strip up high, then down in the middle at the equator. This is now a northerly great circle triangle, and the next one it was an equator, and then it was a southerly hemisphere circle triangle. Other words, the same three pieces were transforming, and they went through condition of 180 degrees at the middle. Now I want to talk about spherical trigonometry, and we can let that go. You've all been brought up on your geometry with the sums of the angles of a triangle always 180 degrees. And I find people think that's just absolutely fundamental. So I'm going to have you go to the North Pole and take a great circle, which is a meridian. You now remember, when I use the word great circle now, I'm sure you go quite along with me, remember what they are. We take a meridian down to the equator. And at the equator, we'll then go one quarter of a way around the Earth, and then we'll take a meridian back to the North Pole. Now, meridians impinge on the equator at 90 degrees inherently. So So if I go around the equator, which is a great circle also, one quarter way around the Earth, and I take a meridian back to the North Pole, I leave the equator at 90 degrees. I get back to the North Pole because I've been a quarter way around the world. Here is 90 degrees of the North Pole, so I've got 90 or 270 degrees. This is a typical spherical triangle, and the sums of the angles are never 180. That's one reason why then I went through that model. Just there. Is it possible? There, look at the spherical triangle, you see. The same spherical triangle in the picture on your screen is now, those are 90 degree corners. Next picture of that, I can't seem to be able to get that series. There are three such triangles in the series. And they should, now there's the same triangle with the 120 degree corners. It's in the northern hemisphere, and the other one is in the southern hemisphere. And then that one more, the middle one, where there's the equator, because at the equator, they're all 180 degrees. In other words, the triangles, the angles can get up to 180. So what we find then is the larger the triangle, spherical triangle, the larger the sum of the angles. As it gets worked towards, I can make just take the equator then, that's 180, we've got a triangle that's 180 at each corner. Now I bring those same three rods and up just a little here, and the angles would be, say, 160 at each corner. Moving it up a little further, they'd be 150 at each corner. And they will finally, as you get the triangles get smaller and smaller, they will approach being 60 degrees at each corner, but they're always going to be a little more. In fact, we discovered what you and I have been brought up as a plane triangle as being normal is the most extreme case of the most local, tiny little triangle. That's really very, very important for you to remember. As we were taught at school, a triangle is an area bound by a closed line of three edges and three angles. A square is an area bound by a closed line of four edges and four angles, all equal, etc. All the geometries that we learned about were areas that were bound by closed lines. That's the way the words were given to us. So that all we have credit about a triangle is what you see on one side of the line. It's a little area inside here. Now the fact is, I said you have to draw a triangle on something, because I'm going to be operational, remember. There's no, even if I say an imaginary triangle, I'm going to be imagining one I scratched in the ground. I continually will imagine a special case. I talked with Sonny Applebyte about this a whole lot last night, that while human minds were able to discover the mathematics of the generalized case, and though we're able to use the principle, we always have to use it, as I showed you the other day, objectively, in special case. And even even though we understand the principle, when we're imagining it, and I gave you conceptuality independent of size, we will always, however, make it into some special, when we make it conceptual, we make the dots of something, we make the points out of something, we tend to very quickly associate, we'll make it pink or something like that, and in a blue background, if we think we're abstracting it. But you'll find that the brain has to use special case. Brain is designed for special case. And only mind has it. So the mind can say to brain, think about conceptual triangle, but the brain will immediately make a special case. These are great nuances of our exploration, but they're all coming out of operational procedure, and sticking strictly to. So I say, when I say to a child, draw me a triangle, he says, where? I say, well, you got to draw me a triangle. So he said, no, I said, how about the ground, drawing the ground? So he draws in the ground. I say, you've drawn four triangles. He said, no, I've just drawn one triangle. And I have to prove to him that he's drawn four triangles. So he coming out of operational procedure and strictly to. So I say, when I say to a child, draw me a triangle, he said, where? I said, you got to draw me a triangle. So he said, I said, how about the ground, drawing the ground? So he draws in the ground. I say, you've drawn four triangles. He said, no, I've just drawn one triangle. And I have to prove to him that he's drawn four triangles. So we're in Philadelphia here. And so he's drawing on the ground here, a little tiny triangle. I said, when you drew the triangle on there, you divided the surface of the, you did it on the earth. And you divide the surface of the system that you did it on into two areas. You'll agree that if I make a circle around the equator, I divide it in northern and southern hemisphere, don't you? If I make the circle a little further north of the equator, I'll have divide the earth into two areas, a large southern and a small northern. If I get a little further north, it's smaller northern and larger southern. So the little boy has drawn a triangle here and subdivided the whole earth into two areas. And both areas are bound by a closed line of three edges and three angles. So I said, you've drawn a very, very big triangle there, all the rest of the earth here. And its corners, you think you got 60, the corners then are 60 from, they're 300 degrees each. It's a big triangle. He said, I'm not used to triangles of 300 degrees. Well, I said, assembly, because your school made you so special and so absolutely myopic as not to pay attention to your environment. That's really, we've got to really think of the reality. And the point is, you have deliberately done something to our earth. You divided it into two areas. He said, I didn't mean to be the beginning. I said, you thought up to now that you were not responsible. Now you are responsible. You're doing that whole work. So he said, well, right, you give me two triangles, a very big one and a very little one. Where are the other two? I said, concave and convex are not the same. And he used to prove that with the reflection and of light, diffusing of light on one side and concentrating light on the other. And so there's always there going to be a big concave and a little concave, and a big convex and a little convex. You've got four triangles. They're always going in four triangles. I mean, our friend the tetrahedron, the accountability is there. This is that generalization of the tetrahedron as the minimum system in the universe, the minimum structure. And it can appear as that kind of a fourness. They will always be there. There's nothing you can do without us being there. So you people say, I can hide away. No, the universe won't let you do this. Just thinking, I said, divides the universe outside us, inside us. Didn't mean to do that, but you are immediately dividing up the universe. What right have you to divide up the universe? Well, you were given this special kind of capability in the mind. And so you can play with total universe. And it's going to be quite exciting to feel those spherical triangles and understand that, incidentally, if you do any of the mathematics of plane trigonometry are exactly the same for the spherical, simply because plane triangle is simply an extremely limited case of spherical triangle. So the mathematics of the spherical triangle, really, there's not such thing as plane trigonometry, it's only spherical. And it's dealing with total systems. And a beautiful complementation of total systems. Now, so we say all you have to do is learn the spherical and the plane is included. Give you the plane and the spherical is not included. Again, the advantage is starting working through the whole of the particular. Now, something else I was brought up with in that schooling was being taught fractions. And the teacher taught me that I couldn't have on top of the fraction elephants and peas below. You had to have elephants both top and bottom. In a fraction. You cannot fractionate dissimilar phenomena. So that all felt fine. That seemed logical. Till we came to trigonometry, and they suddenly began to give you sine and cosine. So I said, what are those words? And show it to me. So I can't really show it to you because it is a ratio between two. It's a ratio between this edge of the triangle and this angle. A ratio is a fraction. So suddenly they were giving me elephants and peas, and that's the same as logical. One reason trigonometry has been difficult to people is because they insist on trying to equate seemingly dissimilar phenomena. But if we get into spherical trigonometry in no trouble at all, because we then realize that the edges of the triangle are simply the arc of the central angle of the sphere. So you have central angles and surface angles, all angles. So your fractions are entirely between angles. That comes very simple and nice, makes you feel pretty good. In other words, the way trigonometry is taught, you absolutely automatically cut the kid's feelings right out. You say this is something not like, these are sines and cosines. They're exempt from the elephants and peas, is it? This is when they say mathematics is something abstract. I mean, forget about all those models. These are the disconnects that I talked to you about when I was trying to find how do we get back to the conceptual and to the exact experience so that humanities can understand all of science, and they can. The more you play with what I'm talking about, the more fun you're going to begin to have. And you're going to find it very easy to take ping pong balls and begin to try out great circles on them. And they're nice to write on ping pong balls, and the colored pens write on them nicely. It's very easy to make great circle rulers. So you find what the diameter of the ping pong ball is, and then you get a little, like a napkin ring that's just half of that, but just the radius in depth. And you sit the little ball in it. And then you just draw on the circle, always great circle. So the ball all different. So get any two points and just connect those points in a lovely great circle. You're going to find a great deal of fun to play with great circles and have concentric triangles and see the way in which the angles begin to decrease. The little man then trying to start with a flat earth and squares and cubes, he said, it is great. And just looking at the inside of the triangle, inside of the square, looking what, nothing. What we do there is teaching him to be absolutely biased. My side is right. My town is inside the wall here. This is incredibly unbalancing to the little child to be exposed to such bias. I hope you feel more and more with me the sense of responsibility to the child, that little child starting out here, and how easy it was to give them misinformation, and how easy it was for parents just loving their kids to pieces to say, well, that rich man got this tutor and he must know it, so we get that tutor, and the tutor tells it his way, and it may be very ignorant. How quickly conditioned reflexes develop about who is authority about what. But the minute you begin to do your own thinking and go back to experiential basis of things, you can't get fooled. And you continually get better information. It's just so exciting, the lovely, clean things. You suddenly, every time you get understanding, it's something you memorize, some little local thing you memorize. Isolated from other things. And right, the gloves used to be always fastened and things. I kept cutting them loose and finally, because you can always set a globe into a circle. As long as the circle is a lesser circle, it's just always so comfortable there. So sit on any bowl, any dish, and so on. So you can have your gloves and really get feeling your whole earth. I suggest to all of you that have plenty of gloves around and begin to get on seeing things this way. When I developed my first map, it was in the 30s, and Life magazine published it in February 1943. They were a year or so getting ready to do it, and we went through some very interesting experiences. The art editor of Life was a great friend. Matter of fact, I'd been on Time and Life, so I knew everybody there, and it was just after I left Life that they decided they'd like to do my map. The Life magazine didn't want to go into something like that without being sure that this wasn't something as well known to geographers long ago, and just sort of rediscovery. And so they got two great experts. One was Dr. Boggs, who was the geographer of the State Department, chief geographer of the State Department. The other was a man who was the president, the chief cartographer of the American Geographical Society. And they got two mathematicians. All of the experts said to the Life magazine, this is what they call, they said, pure invention. Very niggly. I didn't conform to any of the well-known mathematics, therefore obviously it was some kind of a fudging out. So the invention measure sort of fudged. Somehow I tricked everybody. So I have a wonderful patent attorney, he was considered at that time the best in America. It was way back in the 30s. And he said, that's wonderful that we have the great experts testifying as pure invention. Because the chief patent examiner of the United States Patent Office had ruled in 1900 that it was impossible to patent anything cartographic anymore, that all the mathematics had been exhausted, so that it was taboo and never considered. So I got the first and only patent on a method of projection that had been granted in the United States Patent Office, out of all these experts saying it was pure invention. Is this great? Well, anyway, the Life took heart and decided to publish it anyway, and we published it in color, and it was a great hit. As Life and those big magazines do publish to get out a dummy, a little head, and they get, if it looks like a good one, the advertising, they had a 18 pages in of color in it, and you could paste the edges together and put it together. So I'll never forget the Sunday when that had come out. The war was right on, it was deep in there. And I went from Washington to New York that Sunday, and all around the streets I saw kids going around with these globes. It was an unprecedented number for them. They went to two million. They never had any such issue before. Well, Henry Luce was very excited that they're doing this. And there were two couriers coming from Australia going to Churchill in England. The two very specially, and they were just coming through New York, and Henry Luce was handling all the public relations for England in the United States, so he was very privy. These men came to him on their way to Churchill, and Henry decided he'd like to have my map taken to Churchill. He got the printouts before it actually published, so the couriers did take it. So the couriers understand how to show it to Mr. Churchill. I put the pieces together. And what I did was to put the pieces together with Australia at the center. If I could have my... I just moved my map in place here. It was very much the water-ocean world as you see it here. But I made Australia actually the center of it. And they say, gee, that's the way the world really is, isn't it? I just want to point out that the way things look to the local person, that is the way the world is. And then I show them the other way it could be and how they ought to put together Mr. Churchill this way, and they did that too. But all being exactly the same pieces, just rearranged. Incidentally, while Life was making up their mind about whether they would use my map, I'd made many, many drawings, and I had them all little cartoons and so forth. And Henry Luce asked me to come to his house in Westchester for the weekend. He had a number of guests. And after dinner, they asked me to explain my map, so I was doing it on the parlor floor, the people sitting around, sofas, chairs. And Henry was sitting over on one side, and I was explaining many things from the map and grand strategies of different countries and history and so forth, the way the map tended to change with it. And Henry said, "Bucky, every human being has an exact opposite. This is your poles, you have your antipodes on there you've been showing." He said, "You're my exact opposite." I said, that's a very much of a compliment. I said, "How do you happen to give me such high position?" And he said, "Well, you seem to think there's something going on in this universe." He was an absolute free willist. He was sure that, he said, "Anything I want to do, I can do." And you seem to keep introducing large patterns that are super demand. And they said, "I find this very disturbing way of looking at things." That he felt that all the big patterns are purely man-made. I was amazed that people in powerful position can get to see things that way. He was used to enormous, but what his magazine could really do to people around the world gave him that feeling. Now, I like Henry Luce very much. We were good friends for life, and one of the things that I had said at that occasion before the map was published was that there was a northwest spiraling going on of humanity, some totally. The centers of population are moving westward, if we took some total. There had been a time when men drifted east and rafts, but since the sailing business, everybody's really kind of trying to funnel the sun. And quite easy to show that northwest spiral and how then Europe came into North America, and then goes South America, it's going this north. And if you go into the map of the United States, you'll notice I have colors. And the color lines, I have the coldest is the blue, and it gets green, yellow, and the reddest is the warmest. There's a little line here from where you go between yellow and green. In the United States, it goes like that. And you see it here where it may be. You see going right through Europe here. That is the freezing line. That's where the average mean low temperature is 30 degrees. And so north of that line, you might get frozen if you didn't have clothing, for instance. If you're starting with a naked man, was part of a very formidable line at the outset. And I found that line was really remember, I've shown you pictures of where the people are. There was another one where I showed you the lights of where all the people are. But look around that. This way, the enormous numbers are in here. This is where our population is. I find that people tended to get up as close to the cold as they could because the ice was good for preserving things, but you freeze to death. And also, the cooler, you got to where there was less diseases, less infections. Seemed to be the sort of the health area. And humanity had tended to find that. Incidentally, when you get to mountains, there are rings around it. These are simply the sum total around the world. I didn't make separate rings with my colors going up the mountains. But they do have all those temperature changes, you know. So one of the things that fascinated me was the censuses of the United States since 1790. It's quite easy then, demographically, mathematically, to show where the center of population is. And the center of population of America has gone right from the very beginning, was right on that's 30 degrees mean low temperature. And so starting up here very much in Philadelphia, and then goes southward like that, and out and then out in the Indiana, stayed always right along the line. But at the time of the Civil War, the population went just a little north of the freezing line. It had been just below it following it. But Civil War is an amazing moment. This is 1851, production steel. For the first time, man had been doing his primary work really in the fields, and this is the beginning of the industrial, where he's able now to have environment controls, and he goes indoors. So he's able then to be a little north of that line. So there's a tendency to have the industrialization north of the line that is sort of started with beginnings of being able to get north of the line. Anyway, that is the tendency was still to get a little more northerly, so that I saw that the next population, I could really make predictions where they'd be, and they were working more and more northwest. So I also showed this to Henry Luce, and I said what had been called the British Empire that I've talked to you about as being British Empire, which I also shown you, really wasn't British Empire, but really was the East India Company. That the East India Company were that's the actual enterprise, the people who put their money in it, where East India Company was a limited liability, where the individual risker could not be punished if somebody suing the outfit. And we call that incorporated in America, it was LTD and limited in the English world. And the East India Company itself was moving west. The speculators began to move west. And I said to Henry Luce that in due course, this British Empire was going to be the economic controls were moving into North America. And I said that the English, whatever is English, that stays as English at all, is going to really move west. So I said they'll move their headquarters over into Canada in due course. The Canada will begin to be strong, and you find this where their investments are going. So he was very, being then, I said he was being he was an Anglophile. He was born in China. Went to Yale University, but he was born in China. His old China hand had feeling about the English in Hong Kong and so forth. And he was the official public relation propagandist for British Empire during World War II. And so he was concerned when I said the things were moving. There came a day about 6 months after that map business, when he wrote me a note and he said, "Bucky, you're right." he said, "You didn't know this, but excuse me. This occurred before the map, and he had heard me on these things before, and I made my prediction about the English in Nine Chains of the Moon, published in 1938, and." Henry, while I was on Fortune between 38 and 48, this note came from Henry saying, "Lucky, be interested to know that the British had just sent their secret archives to Ottawa." And he said, "You really are right, but you didn't know the war was coming." And I said, "Of course I knew the war was coming. But the point is, how it occurs, why, is irrelevant. All I say is, I'll say to you what is going to occur, but what are the actual critical factors that make it do? They're very happenstance. They're utterly unpredictable. But the big thing is predictable. I think it's important for you to have some feelings of some personal experience in my life that is related to conducting myself the way I am, to give you a sense of confidence yourself. Now, this is not a bad time to tell you about how the method of projection works. Just thinking about the well-known kinds, a maqueta is a very simple thing. You have a cylinder of paper around a globe, and the cylinder of paper is tangent to the globe at the equator. And you have a globe, let's say transparent, and there are the outlines of the continents on it, and there are on the globe there are the latitudes and longitude lines, and we have it lighted at the exact center of the globe, and so the lines, whether it's a continent or the great circles, make lines on the paper, the shadow lines. So we see that the light coming from the center, that where the cylinder is tangent to the globe, things are very absolutely correct. So the Mercator is exactly correct along the equator. Then, as you get further and further north, the angles get wider and wider, and finally, the cylinder paper gets where the light at the center, no matter how far, it will never get to the edge of the cylinder, because the axis of the Earth and the cylinder are parallel. So there's a hole in the top where that you never will be able to get any shadow projected. So the further north you get with the Mercator, the more and more distorted things are. So all the Mercators are actually fudged at the top. They deliberately pull down the data that they know about and just change the pace. Then we have something called polyconic, and the polyconic is what most of the important charting have been done, where you can have, instead of a cylinder, you have a cone. And the cone could just touch the Earth at one point, so where it touched would be accurate, and again, as you go away from the, it's inaccurate. But the polyconic, we have a cone of paper that goes into the Earth and comes out of the Earth again. Can you see a sphere where there's a cone coming like this, and it penetrates here, making a lesser circle, and then it comes out into another circle. Can you see that? So where the two circles occur, they both are accurate, and so the intervening space is less distorted. So polyconic has been by far the least distorted of all the methods of projection in the past. Then there's where you have the light at the center, and this is sitting on a piece of paper, you have what you call a polar azimuthal, and so you may get a circular mapping, very accurate at the point of contact, but gets more and more distorted as you go further and further away. The polar azimuths are very much so. There are other modifications of what I'm saying. Those are the main classes. Now, common to all of those, wherever the sphere touched the sheet of paper, everything was accurate, and if you went away from the point of contact or line of contact, it increased in error quite rapidly. What I did was to take the globe with a spherical icosahedron. I use icosahedron because it has the largest number of identical triangles. Remember that as we get a smaller and smaller triangle, the sums of the angles gets less and less. If I'm going to want to have something out in the flat, then I'd like to get as near to the flat condition as possible, so that there are 20 identical equilateral triangles in our icos, and that's the largest number of absolutely similar forms. You know, then we saw, yes, you can divide that into 120 small right triangles. The amount that the sums of the angles of a spherical triangle add up to over 360 degrees is called spherical excess. When the surveyors are surveying, they use, always watch out for the spherical excess. So I'd like to have the minimum spherical excess. For instance, if I were to use the spherical tetrahedron, its corner angles would be 120 degrees each. So I'd have 120 degrees spherical excess in my triangle. Right? Yeah. So if I use the spherical octahedron, the next system, I'd have 90, 99, 270 above 180, so I'd have 90 degrees spherical excess. Getting down to the spherical icosahedron, each of the corners is 73 degrees and 26 minutes. So I have the when you have the five come together around one, you divide 360 by five, and you come out 720. It's an equilateral triangle, so 720 goes to 60 each corner, 72 at each corner, a spherical triangle, icosahedron, has 72 degrees at each corner. So that when you flatten it into an equilateral triangle, each corner is 60, so that there's only 12 degrees spherical excess at each corner, and a total of 36 degrees for the whole total triangle. In other words, it is the one that has the least spherical excess to start off with. So I said, that's an optimum condition I'm going to have to end it beautiful, because it is the excess divided three ways, which is symmetry. So what will happen is that, because I have 20 of those triangles within the three corners each, so there's 60 packages of 12 degrees each around the map that will subside to 60. And that is really an invisible amount, because the total triangle that subsides will simply contract. So it means that everything shrinks symmetrically. So just the interior of the triangle shrinks a little faster than the edge. The edge, absolutely no change at all. Because where the edge is, it is true contact. So I have by far the most, with those 30 edges of it, 63 degrees, 26 minutes each, you're going to get 30 times 63 degrees, 30 times 60. You have, all this is absolutely true. That's, I have by far the most great circling. It's absolutely true to start off with, and I'm going to have symmetrical subsidence locally. And the beautiful thing about it would be that where this contact, this triangle itself, that is all true. So all the change is internal rather than external. Now, when you make two circles, one of a circle of radius 1, a circle of radius 2, you find that you dismiss your error outwardly in the circle of radius 2. The area of circle of radius 2 is three times the area of circle of radius 1, so that if I dismiss my error outwardly, I have three times as much error as if I dismiss it inwardly. So that there's no way you can get a better condition on spherical excess than on the icosahedron. Just thinking about conditioned reflexes of human beings, I spoke at Haverford University 2 years before we published the world map, and I had all the pieces with me, and the mathematics department asked me to show my method projection, and I did. And he asked me if I'd come home to tea at his house with him, bring the pieces with me, and he had some children, his children, and he wanted the children to play with my map, see what they would do with it. The piece on the floor, and they began to realize how to put the edges together so it would work. And he said, "Darling, you have the world upside down." And of course, there's no up and down in the universe. And the mathematics department man was showing how ignorant he was. The children were absolutely comfortable because there isn't any up and down in the world. Just where you have to, how you want to look at it. But the kids had this freedom. I want to stress this wasn't a matter of the children being ignorant, but that how quickly the reflexes can be misconditioned. If people are a PhD, extraordinary man. Now I'd like to go into watching our time. I think it is time to have a break, and then I'm going to get into some more of the mathematics. That'll end the map for the moment. Are we still on? If we are, I would like to carry on for just a second. There's a couple more things to tell you about that method projection. I'd like you to feel this with me and construct a little model with me in your mind's eye. I'm going to take a steel band, and it's nice and evenly. You'd call it a ruler, a steel ruler, and you can have inches or whatever you want. But a steel band, a nice and flexible one, rather thin, and clearly marked off in these basic increments. And then I'm going to take three such steel bands. I'm putting a hole in the end of the steel band, and I'm going to put liner rivet in there that has a stovepipe through it, so it makes sort of a journal. I'm going to put a rod, two rods, a rod through this end of this steel ruler and a rod through the other. These are very powerful, strong rods. They don't bend. I'm going to take then the steel ruler, these rods are exactly perpendicular to the ends of the steel ruler. I'm going to have them protrude clear through down deeply, and I'm going to take hold of the ends of those rods and bring them together. And you're going to find that it makes the steel band very beautifully, and the rods come to common center here. So it makes kind of a circular triangle, radius, arc, radius. Now I'm going to take three such bands, and I'm going to, where the corner, make a triangle with them, and bring the corners together, then again having a swiveling rivet go through the hole of the corners, and these powerful rods can come through. We've got three rods and three corners, and the thing is standing up with a flat triangle like that, these three legs. Now, I take the hold of the bottom of those legs, which are stiff, and bring them together. As I do so, we found that any two of them coming together made the single band bend, didn't it? So all three bands have to bend, because there's three rods, each one, any pair of them, at the ends of any one steel band. So as I pull them together, all three steel bands bend. And as they do so, the farthest, any one side of the triangle with the bend rotates away from the opposite angle, due to the rods also being brought to a common center, because they come to the center of gravity. So you see that it makes each one of these arcs bend outwardly, and which they're able to do, rotating away from each other. We then really get that's what that spherical triangle was that I had. I simply took those rods, the powerful rods, and brought them to a common universal joint. And we're able then, the bands in this case were a delicate, very powerful aluminum, high oil, 73 ST aluminum. So you could go, that really was a sphere showing itself here. As the rods went northerly and southerly, it kept just embracing the earth, the spherical triangles just opening a little further, closing a little further. I want you to understand then how then you're able to take a band of even module, absolute module, and make it into the spherical. I want you to understand this just to get your own confidence that the edges of the triangles, which are done that way, exactly that way, it would be possible to take a light at the center of the sphere and project through a spherical icosahedron. But if you did, to a planet paper outside, you'd find as it went through the arc to the plane, the angles begin to open up, so there's not uniform module scale, uniform boundary scale. This is absolutely uniform boundary scale. That's the only projection in history where you don't break open your package. In the Mercator, you're breaking open the top. You always have something open-ended. You have a line or two reference, and the triangle ends. But in this one, the line or two reference is continuous to the triangle, never breaks open, always contains, and brings about the symmetry. I want you to really feel quite confident, comfortable about what goes on here. So this really amounts to it's a really topological transformation and not a shadow graph. So the words projection would have to be a mathematical projection, but not a shadow graph. It's a true projection, all right, but it is mathematical transformation and not a shadow graph. Now I'm ready to break, sir. Again, in the techniques of our medium that we're dealing in, the video scope, and I have a great supply of slides that you know. One of the things we learn is that the video frames, picture frame, is just a little smaller than the 35 millimeter slides, so that we have what I usually like to show vertically may have to be shown horizontally. And I'm going to review really quite quickly those great circles that I had of the, maybe the pumping of the basically, instead of it being vertical like that, coming down, it's going to be horizontal. So let me have the first slide. And in this, I think you'll enjoy it a little more. It's a good idea to get this feeling about spherical trigonometry. You see the triangle up at the top, mounted out horizontally this time. That's we're dealing about a 72 degree angle up there. Next picture. And here we're down to 120 degree angles. Next picture. Now we're at 180 degree angles. Next picture. Now we're going to the negative spherical trigger, down in the southern hemisphere, down to about 90 degrees. But you really feel that transformation of how a triangle can rotate this way and changes. So we've had absolutely uniform boundary scale the whole time, and just simply change the angle. The angle is a variable. Remember when we were talking about the necklace structure, and I was getting into structures, we found that the struts didn't change, only the angles change. And I look for what are the varying things. You begin to get a feeling very strongly about angles. In fact, I've discovered that you can describe all designing can be done with just two phenomena, one called angle and the other frequency. I'm going to have an axis of reference. So in relation to axis of reference, as I said, with a vector, I'm going to go off deliberately, start at this angle. I'm going to go off like that. And now, I say it's angled, so I may not go off in a plane. I can say my angle goes. The point is I'm going to go for so many frequencies. For so many frequencies this way, then I change my angle, so many frequencies, so many, another change the angle. So all you do is change the angle and frequency. And then you finally can outline, shape anything you want. I think that might be said. Otherwise, you said, I understand angle all right, but you say measurement you go so far. But I use the word frequency for measurement. Now, next picture, please. I'm going to go through more and more of my slides. Here, again, we're showing something horizontally. Up at the top, you see your three possible structures, the tetrahedron, three triangles around each corner, octahedron, four triangles around each corner, icosahedron, five triangles around each corner. And at the bottom of that array, you'll see a tetrahedron, and it's about by my shoulder here. And then it's not really very well done. We have a series of the corners, three triangles coming together, and then it goes four triangles coming together, then five, then it goes six, and it's a plane. You can see it's a plane. That's why it can't be part of a system, because it doesn't come back in itself. And then it goes, the next one goes the negative five, the negative four, the negative three. So there's just the same going between the northern and southern hemisphere idea. Next picture, please. Now, here if we can sharpen this up all you can to see, yeah. I have an array, and I want to look into something on the, what would be the left-hand column, as you're looking at it. Up at the top, there's one ball. And then below it, there'd be two balls, and then there's three balls and four balls. What I'm studying here are relationships between numbers of unique events. And up at the top, one ball doesn't have any communication to communicate to anybody. It takes two balls to have communication or relationship. Like I said, there's no otherness, no me. My awareness really begins with the otherness, because it must be some relationship. So if I have two balls, how many private telephones we have to have to talk between this A and B? You need only one private telephone, because there's just A and B. So two people have one telephone. I'm going to have three people. So there's A, B, and C. So I'm going to have a telephone A, B, A, C, and B, C. I'm going to have three telephones. Telephone system, any two people must have an absolute private wire. So now I'm going to have four people, A, B, C, and D. I'm going to have And what you're looking at up on the left-hand column there are the telephone wires between little points. And the it's so between A, B, and C, A, B, C, D, I'm going to have A, B, A, C, A, D. That's three of them. Then I have to have B, C, and B, D. That's five. And then I have to have C, D. That takes six. Four people have to have six private wires. This is our friend tetrahedron, which has to have six edges. The four require six connectors. So, in fact, you find this gets to be a sort of fundamental model that way. You find then the next, yeah, there are two columns I have up there. One is then the actual number of telephone wires you have, and then we put up the number, because if the first case we found we needed none, then we start with one between two, three require three, four required six, and five required. Now I'll tell you n to the second power minus n over two, because you find it, you actually learn the equation, n to the second power minus n over two. So I have five. N is five. So n to the second power is 25 minus five is 20. So divide by two is 10. You can find have 10. So the numbers are going like 1, 3, 6, 10. Our next one would be 6. So 6 to the second power is 36 minus 6 is 30, divided by 2 is 15.
You want to draw that on here?
It would be nice if we could have the chart really.
Because it can't get much clearer than it is, and you could probably see it better if it was drawn.
Oh.
But do it your way.
You're going to introduce this later then, or what?
If you wanted to just draw it, the connections on the board, you could see.
I see. I think you're getting it in your own perfectly clearly. So I have a series of columns back. If I could go back to the drawing itself. The first one was that all the people in the telephone wires. Then the next is a summary of how many telephones are needed. Is a vertical line of columns. Now I find that those numbers, 1, 3, 6, 10, 15 are actually the total number of balls in a triangular collection. Just have one ball, then three balls, then you get six balls in the next triangular collection. 1, 2, 3. Remember, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. The next one is 15. So we find that the numbers of relationships are triangular numbers, of course. I guess it'd be very interesting. Then you find that those triangular numbers are fascinating because if I take three balls, for instance, and I sit them on the, what the next is, six, 3 plus 6 equals 9. Or if I took the six and had it sit on the 10, I get 16. If I took the 10 and put it on the 15, I get 25. What do you get? 9, 16, 25. These are second powers. In other words, any two sets make what we call the second power. I don't use the word square anymore, you notice. I always say second power, third power, fourth power. I never get caught with saying square and cubing. So we find then that here's a triangle sitting on top. The triangle always one ball less, sitting on top of one, and it makes a second power number. You find that you take that top one and hinge it over, it lays over, it makes a diamond. And when you look at that as a diamond, may I have the picture itself back here, because we have these pictures of the diamond then. You'll see they're stacked up there, and then we get into the diamonds where a diamond simply is a square, but remember, these nest at 60-degree angles, they're 90. So it's a diamond. And you can count up them. You can understand it's a second power to see how the second half completes how the six completes the 10. Now, that Then we find that if I stack these layers, two layers together, and then I get tetrahedron vertically. So I find that whereas the you and I need a private telephone, or any two of us want that private telephone, I have that in there. I could also then call those the relationships between our experiences. So your child have an experience, they have another experience. So what's the relationship to it? If you understand, you begin to understand the relationship between the experiences. So then I find that if I stack all my relationship or all my experiences together, in the end comes out a tetrahedron of such and such a frequency. In other words, the numbers of the telephone were triangular numbers, and the sums of all, and of which is these numbers of telephones then is the numbers of experience I've had in my life. These are all the relationships between all the experiences I've had in my life. But these are all the understandings I have of all the experiences I've had in my life. It's understanding the relationship to those points. That's what those triangular numbers are, the understandings of a relationship. So then those are individual experiences. Now, I keep integrating this set of understandings with a new one. I've just had a new experience. So the final tetrahedral stack up there is a sum of all the relationships between all the experiences you have. Really understand being a comprehensivist in the way I carry on with you is very much relating then to all those relationships. So I'm really carrying on in a very tetrahedral manner, as far as that it comes out in this elegant, beautiful tetrahedron. Just one more, whatever it is, always comes out a whole rational tetrahedral form, or a whole triangular form. I find this very exciting. What I call this then the underlying orderliness in superficial disorder, where the experiences seem to you and I very disorderly and random, but suddenly find the whole underlying whole thing absolute order. You can't become disorderly. It becomes really very exciting matter. Now, how about the next picture then? I told you earlier about the two general dynamics scientists who are making experiment with titanium sheet. They're making experiments with titanium relative to re-entry problems in the rocketry. Remember that? I had two hemispheres, one half an inch less in radius than the other, and that they were concentrically arranged, and then they were actually sealed up, welded up at the bottom, and so there's a space between each one of them, a half inch. And then they clamped it into a frame, and this is what you're looking at in the picture, and the atmosphere is able to come in underneath the frame into the inside of the dome. So the atmospheric pressure pushes the inner dome outwardly like that, as it has very normally. But you exhaust through the vacuum pump the air between the two, so the atmosphere operating in the outside one pushes it in towards the other one, and it dimples in, I spoke about dimpling, and dimples in the exact icosahedral. This happens to be it turns into be a four-frequency geodesic tensegrity structure. In other words, I had also been giving you the way the molecules of gases operate and so forth, and this is the... I said they want to get the most economical, which means always a great circle. So they insist not on lesser circles, they get wrapped beautifully into the whole great circles. And when two great circles, remember, Clausius did this, but three great circles, triangle. And now there's all this triangulation in there, and an enormous amount of action, so they average out an equilateral. They keep trying to get absolute equilateral. So the whole thing just makes itself get orderly. Time and again, I get so excited and find how beautiful life is really carrying on, how the universe, under all these things going on around us, but there is this lovely order. Next picture. It's fun to see what's going to come up here. Now, we see three lines crossing one another. Now, one of the great differences between myself and the mathematicians is that all the mathematicians assume you can have a plurality of lines go through the same point at the same time. If you get in geometry where they get into the non-Euclidean geometry, get in hyperbolic, they assume still plurality of lines going to the same point at the same time. This is exactly what physics finds can't happen. Because I said a line has to be in action. They have their lines going to the same point at the same time as a point. And I simply say to you that the lines, then, if one could go through it, then another. If you have a machine gun and a bullet coming like that, you could have another machine gun and synchronize them so one went through, then the other. And it might look like a couple of lines crossing, but they're not. So the, may I have the next, hold the picture a minute. I want you to notice then how those three lines are really crossing. And what they do, they have to be, one has to be superposed on the other. So they just automatically do what's going on here. May I have the next picture, please? And this next picture, you see what the physicist is doing. The difference between them, between the mathematician and the physicist is that you find that when two events, because a line is an event, there's just no question about it. You can't have it, just imaginary. I proved that to you yesterday. So we have an event, and there's already an action taking place. Therefore, there's what we call an interference. And with an interference, it could be a glancing blow, and be what you call then a refraction. Just still ticking here, and it changes angle a little. That brings about refraction of light, incidentally. That's exactly that. There can be a very tight blow like that. I have the picture back and again, and oh, I see. We get then a bounce off. Then there can be another one where they go in first through, and then there's fourth one where we have a smash up. Now, these are all the things that go on in the cloud chamber when the physicist is bombarding, sending a neutron or whatever. Maybe you can certainly see these bouncings around. And they are all to do then refracting, reflecting, refracting, reflecting, smashing. Or the one-fourth one half, where they're going almost the same direction, they get what we call critical proximity, and they get one of those mass attractions, they become one. If the angles of convergence are close enough, then you really can see that mass attraction taking over and then pull over. We had a very interesting experience in the Navy in World War I. I told you I was in a transport service where we took these 130 men over. Basically, with the German submarines and enormous houses, they tried running at night without lights. Of course, they didn't want any lights, because the submarine watched for and laying off there, watching, silhouetting against those lights and so forth. So lights are anathema, so they didn't want any lights. So these enormous groups of ships were going together, and they wanted to stay together. And yet you had the enormous danger of following the other man at night. It was a torturous kind of a game. On one occasion, two of the big transports found, just in avoiding in trouble, one at the end of one got overlapping the other, like that's pretty close. There were two big ships, the Agamemnon, the Mount Vernon, and the George Washington, both big ships up in the 30 or 40,000 tons, big. And they got where, being in the water and being big ships, their mass was enough so they began to attract one another. That's when you get big ships at sea, they really begin to show that mass attraction. You don't see two apples sitting on the table. The pull of gravity is so great, there's friction of the apple on the table, they don't try to go towards each other. But these two ships are free at sea, and acceleration on their finally being pulled together. And if they'd ever gotten over, the seas were heavy, they would just chewed each other up and lost. I think involved on that particular case, there were some, they would have lost about 20,000 human beings. The captains of these two ships tried to see what they could do, because the mass attraction, if you try to get too fast, the bow would come over and so forth. They tried to figure out how to, one could accelerate a little faster than the other, and they made troubles. They finally found all they could possibly do was to open up an angle between them and keep them apart. The idea that finally could pull apart to get out of that critical proximity, because of the second power business. They finally did, but they were actually a whole day pulling apart. So when I spoke about lines coming together, one that you can have then a light refraction. One you could refraction, real bounce off. You could have a smash up, or you could have angle of convergence be so delicate that you have critical proximity and a possible fall-in. Those are all the things that happen in the cloud chamber. This is all the physicist deals in. And this is exactly where the mathematician completely lost. He's lost all the privilege of thinking because he said the lines are going through the same point at the same time. This is typical, again, of but these false assumptions that superficially said it's obvious. They said two lines go through a point. Anybody see that? Two chalk lines on the blackboard. But the actual fact, if I do it on the board, chalk or whatever it may be, look on here, you'll see it literally cross exactly like two, let's go in the snow, and you have the tie go this way. The next one, the top one, quite clearly, is absolutely separate. It always is.